Hello everyone, welcome back to the Subscribe blog, this time not with a device to cloud story, but something completely different. I have here, now this is funny, I'm looking at you, Richard Sirotor, one of our Microsoft MVPs, who has been doing fantastic work with Service Bus for the longest time, and with integration, he's been very active in the integration community. And you brought some things to show and to share. We met just a few weeks ago at a conference in a community conference in London, and you did some really interesting talks about Service Bus and integration with I think even Salesforce. And so what did you bring today?
Yeah, thanks for having me. I think it's you know, it's a fun time to be doing integration stuff, given the explosion of SaaS, and that, you know, you look at these surveys and each one shows like 90% of CIOs worry about getting their stuff stuck in these SaaS platforms.
Yep.
So it's such a great time to be looking at, a lot of people solve the ETL problem, but still Microsoft seems to be the only one solving the kind of real-time integration problem with the relay service and async messaging. And this is really still a really valuable space that somehow everyone else isn't tackling with the same fervor. So I've been playing around with Salesforce stuff for a while for a few reasons. I mean, one, it's the market leading SaaS CRM platform, hundreds of thousands of customers. They do really innovative tech stuff. And honestly, they do free developer accounts. I mean, that's the one thing that got me started with this about 4 or 5 years ago, was anybody can sign up and mess around in the platform. So I thought, why not? Let's see if we can take two very conflicting technologies, anything from Salesforce and Oracle and something from Microsoft, and let's see how they play together.
Yeah.
So I did a lot of different things, just consuming services. So they've got a, it, you know, it's interesting to consume people's services, but they have a couple of things that really made the Service Bus shine. So they do outbound communication. So it's, how do I have stuff in server in Salesforce talk to stuff on premises, which is really hard.
Yes.
In most systems. So Service Bus solves that, obviously, with a few different things. So showing demonstrations of having, let's say, a web system where I've got people mobile, I've got people around the world accessing pages in Salesforce, but I want to look up data in my on-premise ERP system, Wine and Business System, SharePoint, whatever. You can really make that happen with Salesforce and the Service Bus. So that was the first thing I wanted to show off, is one of my favorite demos of just, I mean, you know, sometimes when you have some of these SaaS vendors come in there, they say our integration strategy is give us all your data.
Yeah.
I hate that strategy.
Yes, that's right.
It's a lazy synchronization strategy, which is fraught with all sorts of errors and problems. It's the easy one,
that's right,
quote unquote. But why do I want to duplicate logic and business data and reference data that's maybe slow moving or maybe really fast moving? And I don't want to sync, or I don't want to do real-time lookups.
Yep.
So first thing I thought I would show you is a demonstration of doing a real-time lookup.
Oh, great. So share the screen. Let's go.
Great. So yeah, we've got Visual Studio here. And, you know, again, I think the part that people like myself love about Service Bus stuff is I'm not rebuilding my service to make it work with this, right? I mean, it's a traditional, in this case, WCF service. So let's imagine the example I gave in London, and people, hopefully it resonates, is sometimes a lot of these sales vendors guys like to come in and visit your campus, especially I'm sure the Microsoft campus, when there's a really good thing in the cafeteria for the day. So what happens if you had an internal service that shows up what you're serving in each cafeteria every day?
Yep.
And your internal people use that to figure out where they're walking around. Why wouldn't your sales guys also maybe say, I'm only going to visit Clemens when you really have, you know, a heck of a good corned beef ready to go today. So
of course,
whatever
I
that's
work,
gonna be. So let's,
I work at home and my wife is cooking, which means it's always fabulous. I have to say this because my wife might be watching this episode, you know.
That's good. So you need this more than anyone. So.
But if assume I was at my, I would be working at Microsoft campus like everybody else is. Yes.
Yeah. So again, the lazy integration strategy would be, hey, let's say every Monday I'm going to go upload a bunch of weird restaurant, you know, food-based stuff to my Salesforce platform and pollute it with unrelated data. I mean, that doesn't seem like a good use of resources.
No.
So what I have here is a simple WCF service that has a very basic contract that simply, you know, get menu. It's going to be RESTful. You're going to have a URI template that just, what site is it? If there's a couple different sites on campus, what's the date? It returns me back something from the menu. You know, the implementation for demo purposes is comically simple, where I'm just loading one for each different site. So, you know, I mean, again, the fun stuff with the Service Bus is adding a few configuration settings, which are often much longer than my actual service implementations. But in this case, for demo purposes, to start off with, I'll start off even with just with a none to prove things work perfectly fine.
Yeah.
So if I run this particular application, so at this point, you know, the service bus relay started, and what I'm doing is I'm showing just hitting this in the browser. That's why REST services are always so much fun, is I can put in different values. I mean, again, the fun of the relay service is I'm calling a service running on my machine. So now I've got something hitting it via public internet addressable URL coming in on my machine. I can see that happening. It keeps requesting menus. So how do I then start applying this then to Salesforce? So this is where the fun is here, is that let's say I've got this website and I'm running it up here and I'm looking at, I'm trying to set up menu details. Like Salesforce kind of uses a MVC pattern when you're building custom pages.
Mm-hmm.
So I can see that I've set things up. Actually, I probably want to change my page even to menu lookup. And so you can use everything out of the box. If you want to build custom pages, you write a C-sharp Java-esque language called Apex to actually talk to an endpoint. So in this case, what I can do is very, very simply still talk to the service bus and even do it securely. So in the code here, I can do things like start calling the service bus, pass in my credentials with the owner and the password.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the scope I'm referencing. I get back my token and manipulate that into the right wrap token I want to then send with the service bus. And then it's really as simple as taking in whatever parameters they've selected, putting that into my REST service, putting the right authorization header in there, assuming I turn authorization on, and parsing the result that comes back as XML. So in this case, you know, I've got a service. When I click get menu, what I'm going to hope happens is it actually pulls menu results from my service on my machine. And sure enough, it pulls the different food options that are sitting here in a service on my machine. So here the Salesforce user is already creating accounts, doing whatever they're doing. Maybe they jump to a special page that's linked on their dashboard that says, yep, call this service that maybe looks up the ERP system or looks up a menu or does any of this sort of thing to do synchronous request reply on premises from a SaaS platform. For me, that's unlocking a lot of possibilities there.
I have to say I'm pretty impressed, not because that's you know, news to me personally, but this looks really nice. I mean, this is very, it is enormously powerful if you look at it that way. I mean, what you did is you took a effectively standard REST service or and just exposed it in that way from your machine, and that your machine will typically not be, you know, this is not something you do from the laptop, but really what you have is you have this data sitting in your backend servers that are sitting in your corporation somewhere, and you want to make them available for people are using SaaS applications. And this is a good example here. And also what I like about the example certainly is that it is specifically not dynamic CRM, because there could be Microsoft, you know, special Microsoft sauce, but this is basically just you going in and calling this from Salesforce into a service that exists. So that's a very powerful thing.
Well, I think it's the interop story that it's easy to take things for granted sometimes for Microsoft and others that, yeah, of course it works in Dynamic CRM or it works in SharePoint or it works in whatever. If I can build it here, my point when I often show this is, okay, I showed you this in Apex and Salesforce. At this point now, there's literally, you could do this anywhere where there's not an SDK, because obviously you guys ship great SDKs. So if I'm doing stuff in Ruby, I'm doing stuff in Java, I don't even need to sling this code. I can just use the SDK, but when I'm using SaaS platforms where maybe they only give me certain types of hooks, I might have to jump down to their lowest level objects. And because it's pretty interoperable web stuff, I'm doing things like parsing ACS tokens and
yep.
making calls, really no problem.
Yeah.
So
I mean,
that really lends to that. Yeah, jump in.
I mean, in this particular scenario, what you got here, if you go and show the code again, where you call the access control service, so first of all, calling the access control service is not hard. Certainly not. You can see what you're doing here is effectively you're just doing a post against the wrap endpoint that we have on ACS. You could one of the little secrets is you can actually go and get the same token from the OAuth endpoint. We haven't shown that all that much. But what you get here is really a token that is just for use at service bus. So if you really would have to, so if you have an existing client that needs to go and talk out, but you have some other authentication mechanism in place, mm-hmm. you can even run the relay endpoint completely unauthenticated, as you've shown in your example, and then rely on the standard, whatever authentication mechanism you have in your app, if you understand your tokens. And the only difference would be that you allow unauthenticated traffic through the relay towards your app, and your app kind of is all responsible, completely responsible for its own defense. Mm-hmm. And with what you got here, obviously, there is no way that unauthenticated traffic can even get past the service bus endpoint, even into your app. So it gives you an additional layer of security.
Absolutely. And in this case, that worked well because you can jump to code. There's different scenarios. And the one other thing I thought I'd show before I jump into the additional part of the demo is the fact that Salesforce also has a pretty cool asynchronous kind of webhook capability where you can come in and specify, hey, when certain conditions happen, fire this sort of event.
Okay.
So I can say, for example, what they call an outbound message. And again, that Dynamics kind of has this, but what's really cool is you can set up a condition that might say, every time someone creates a really large opportunity, I don't want to sync this every day. I want to start notifying people. I want to do things. And so you specify an endpoint URL that it posts to, and it gives you a WSDL based on whichever field you feel like sending it up. So, okay, whenever there's a new opportunity, give me the amount, the customer ID, the close date, whatever, generate a WSDL for me. And now I can consume this in a WCF service using the service util function and give myself a contract, implement it, and consume it. Now, the tricky thing, though, is that in this case, I have no control over the HTTP pipeline. So when this runs, it just posts to that endpoint. So I can't really use ACS secured services because I have no chance to inject the header.
Yeah.
So, what I've played around with, and I always love your feedback on this, is what I've often done is part of this pipeline, I actually inject just a random long GUID into the payload and then check for that on the receiving side. So some way to make sure I'm not just exposing an unauthenticated service, insert some sort of token that I can check for on the other side, even though I can't use ACS to secure it. So sometimes you do have to get a little creative when you don't control the HTTP pipeline. And, you know, I just have to post, all it does is send a client certificate, which is cool. But my understanding is service bus strips out client certs before it passes them down to the actual relay listener.
Yeah, it does. So, but you're using HTTPS on that path, which means ultimately what you do is you use a shared secret.
Yeah.
You're using the old school W security header with the plain text password effectively. That's kind of thing you're doing because that's SOAP traffic, right? And I think that is it's safe against eavesdropping and safe against manipulation because TLS does that for you. And then ultimately, yes, it's probably not the best form to share a secret across the wire. But if that's what you have, then that's what you have, right? Because if you can't influence what that endpoint is, and if that's the amount of control you get through the platform, that's better than nothing.
That's what I figured. And then something, it's funny, after we got back from London, somebody had emailed me again, and they often ask, like, they like the relay demo, but what about topics and queues? Because I want to be able to post to topics and queues from these things. Not everything's a relay, even a one-way. I just wanted to do fire and forget sort of stuff. So I took time last week and actually built then a example of a page. And again, you can imagine this. If I'm using a SaaS platform every day, there might be errors or conditions within maybe the accounts or some sort of ticketing.
Yep.
Where I don't want to alt-tab them over to my ticketing system. I'd rather have a view, but at the same time, I'm not persisting the data here. It's just, again, it's a dumb facade that lets me submit something. So being able to have a notification, pick a date, and say something big happened. The nice thing is when I submit this, I'm actually going to write this to a topic. And so the trickiness here, and honestly, you guys haven't documented this a ton yet, so this was a little fun trial and error for me, was what's the right format for sending a brokered message over just raw HTTP? And so I was able to piece together very Sherlock Holmesian kind of one of the
it's actually very points. Simple, but go on.
And it ended up being pretty simple once I was done. Was, you know, it's the same process at the beginning to get my ACS token. So again, it's nice to be able to reuse some very common logic. And then it really came down to what's the right way to post to it. So in this case, posting to a ticket topic and hitting messages URL, it's a post, doing a text plane so I can process it as a simple string and a string on the other side. Pretty cool is that being able to set the broker properties. I mean, again, I'm used to using topics and queues via the SDK, and you're setting labels and you're setting some of these cool meta properties. But even setting this programmatically, again, a simple JSON header, it defines whatever broker properties you want to have, an expiration policy, any of the core things is about a dozen or so.
Yep.
then being able to set the custom header. So in this case, I wanted to throw the account into the properties payload that comes in, and I could even do routing based on. So again, I think it's pretty cool that I might be able to submit a ticket from my SaaS platform, and then based on maybe which account it is or which geography I might set, it could route it to different places based on the subscriptions I can create off of these headers. So setting all this just via raw HTTP stuff, no SDKs to help out.
So one of the principles we're following, so you're setting a body here. If you have absolutely minimal data to send, the simplest way you can go and do is key value pairs. Turns out HTTP has a nice facility for key value pairs, which is the headers, which is what I call this jokingly NHTTP, non-hypertext transfer protocol. Because if you set content length to zero and do a post and you just set headers, then anything that is not a magic header in HTTP, we're simply going to go and take as a payload header and just map that to the properties in the message. And we're also doing that if you fetch the messages out using HTTP, we're going the same way. And then, of course, what you do here is additionally you set a JSON body, and whatever comes in as the body on the message gets put into the gets stuck into the body of the message that we route, and that can also pop out in the same way on AMQP or on our proprietary SBMP protocol.
Very interesting. Yeah, so in this case, here, what's going to be the easiest thing to consume on the other side? If you're going to throw it in JSON, I can use JSON.net to receive it. So if I'll break my first rule of demos by clicking something that I haven't tried it out in a week, we'll see if everything works.
It's got
all right, so it did submit it for processing.
Sweet.
If I look at my service plus topic, I should see in one of my subscriptions, I should see that I've got some messages queued up there. I got a couple messages. Who knows what I've been posting there.
Yep.
So if I look at my app, part then was, again, processing this as a stream.
Exactly.
And so all I did was, again, once I pulled the message, and I thought it'd be fun to show the SDK on the other side, because you can do things against the raw HTTP, the SDK on the other side. You don't have, there's no magic here. You can really use whatever makes sense on both sides.
Yeah.
In this case.
And that's a goal that we have, right? The stream is the magic place where we don't do serialization. So that's how you get to the raw data that you got here. And the way you can go and figure this out dynamically, because I mean, here, you know, on both sides, but you can set there. We made content type magic as a special property. You can go and set it and then read it and then go and make a decision of whether you want to go do this. And if you're using AMQP, you have a complete liberty to go and set maps and set lists and kind of use the AMQP model. And then you can go and pull those things out with collections of objects and dictionary of string and object and objects that we're putting in there, and basically use the dynamic programming model completely against that to make it easy.
Yeah, it's pretty powerful stuff. So in this case, it makes it really easy to pull out custom properties. It still behaves the same way, where I'm just able to yank them right out of the brokered message. I don't even have to process them as HTTP headers. It's just obviously smart enough to take that in and then process it out. So again, if I run this, what should hopefully happen is I'm simply yanking a message off the queue, or if the topic in this case off my subscription, able to read things like the headers and able to see what's going on. And it really makes it nice. So, you know, moving forward, I think it's a pretty cool way to be able to, from any platform, send messages in asynchronously as well, because Relay is great for demonstrations of obviously request, reply, RPC sort of stuff. Plenty of this stuff is kind of a fire and forget. This is interesting. I don't care who gets it or who wants to do something with it. You guys figure it out. I don't want to hold up my processing thread. So, again, I think there's a really interesting story. I mean, Salesforce is an absolute dominant player in the space, and they've actually continued to ask me to continue to write about this stuff because, yeah, their customers say, how do I get my data out? How do I integrate with the rest of my probably very deep data center application portfolio? And this sort of stuff in the service bus really ties that in nicely.
So you have a lot. So in Salesforce world, that's a up and coming or popular way of doing that kind of work.
Yeah, I mean, this is really resonating. I spoke at the Salesforce Dreamforce conference last year. I spoke at a user group back in the spring, and this sort of stuff is unfamiliar to some of that crowd because, again, they might not look this out as just a Microsoft service. They look at some other tools that do ETL based stuff. But when you start looking at needing to do real-time messaging and getting away from kind of the lazy ETL pattern, there really is, this is the best story I think at play right now, is the combination of relay and brokered messaging. Obviously, no one else is doing that combination.
Yeah, and so on the messaging side, obviously, one of the things that we have new, which will work also with what you got here with the, you know, posted with the HTTP and then pull it out, is using the AMQP path, as I just said. Mm-hmm. Now we have really not only pretty good, we have actually really good support for JMS. Mm-hmm. One thing that's funny is that we have, you know, one or two perf bugs that I know that are in the .NET client, which are being fixed immediately. Right? It's all in the, but it's like tiny little things which are slightly annoying if you know about them. Sure. And they, you know, they happen when the moon shines and it's Sunday and under certain circumstances. But the GMS implementation is better in that respect because it's sitting on top of the AMQP Proton stack. And that's also, I would say, a fairly, some customers are expressing surprise that we're actively supporting an Apache project with Proton, mm-hmm. Proton C, Proton J. Mm-hmm. And we actually have people who are committing into it now. And that's something that Microsoft will recommend to people as an interoperable thing, because we really believe that bridging those things, building those hybrid solutions, even from force.com into, you know, a company environment where everything is written in Java, is a realistic scenario that we can go and help with and we have a good service for.
No, absolutely. And again, even some of the BizTalk services stuff and some of these other adapters, you could realistically be using this to bridge Salesforce with your on-premise Siebel system. And you know what? That's a viable scenario. Why not? I mean, at the end of the day, you just need to solve problems and some of these glue technologies that, again, things you just couldn't have done 5 years ago. It's pretty compelling stuff.
That is absolutely fantastic. I thank you very much for that demo. I think that's an eye opener for me, but certainly for a lot of customers too, potentially. This is not something that just lives inside of the Microsoft stack, that if you build truly hybrid solutions, not only hybrid in the sense of cloud and on premises, but really hybrid in the sense of something built on this platform, something built on this platform. You got to go and make those things interoperate. That mm-hmm. messaging is great, and that the thing we have in the cloud to go and build that bridging is actually applicable to a lot of platforms and not only the things that we have directly in the Microsoft platform. So thank you very much for spending some time with me and showing me that.
Absolutely. It's great. Thank you.